Keith Locke.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Green Party will be supporting this bill as a way of modernising the functioning of the Governor-General's office. We agree with the Government Administration's Select Committee that it would make the financial arrangements for the support of the Governor-General more transparent and simpler to administer than they now are, and it would also remove the Governor-General's tax-exempt status, which is appropriate in a modern democratic society. It is unfortunate that the Select Committee didn't respond positively to two submissions for amendments to the bill to change the way that we choose the Governor-General, or at least the way in which we decide which person's name is forwarded to the Queen, or if it becomes a King, for approval. As the Select Committee put it in their commentary, these two submitters who advocated a change wanted a new process that would require, quote, them to be elected by Parliament to ensure, this is them being the Governor-General, to be elected by Parliament to ensure that consultation occurs and a neutral candidate is chosen who is acceptable to the greatest number of members of Parliament and the public, end quote. The Select Committee wrongly decided that this issue lay outside the scope of the bill. The Green Party does not agree. There is nothing in the title of the bill, the Governor-General Bill as it's called, or any purpose clause which prevents a section on the appointment and the dismissal of a Governor-General being added. This is what the submission of the Republican movement proposed, and the submission by Derek Round went in the same direction. At the moment, the selection of a nominee for Governor-General is not democratic. I, as a Member of Parliament from a non-government party, have no input whatsoever. It is done entirely by the government of the day, and we have a history of some clearly political appointments. Sir Keith Holyoake, a former National Prime Minister, appointed by a National Government, is a case in point. The Government is unlikely to appoint someone who might have a record of being critical of the policies of the particular party currently in government. It is hard in this modern age not to agree that we need a more democratic process. The proposal of the Republican movement was for a clause specifying that, quote, the Governor-General is appointed by the Sovereign on the recommendation of the House of Representatives, end quote. It proposed that the recommendation on a nomination have the agreement of at least half of the parliamentary leaders of all political parties represented in Parliament, and that the parties they lead contain at least 75% of the MPs in the House. The Greens agree with this general direction, and in the committee stages of this bill, I will be moving an amendment similar to this, the one proposed by the Republican movement, only a bit simpler. My amendment will simply say that the nomination has to have the support of 75% of the members of this House. This is not an entirely new idea. The Republican movement submission pointed out that the parliaments of Papua New Guinea and Solomon Islands already elect their Governor-General nominee to be forwarded to the Queen. The Republican movement submission also allowed for a dismissal process with a similar proportion of the House of Representatives having to agree. And my amendment in the committee stage will specify that dismissal will require 75% of the members of the House having to agree. Democratising this dismissal process is important because at the moment, if the government of the day is called to order by the Governor-General, the government can fire off a note to the Queen advising her to dismiss the said Governor-General immediately, and the Queen is required to act on the advice of the Government of New Zealand. This power of the Government of the day over the Governor-General does inhibit the true independence of the person who holds that office and is acting as Head of State in New Zealand on behalf of the Queen. The Republican movement also picked up another good point, that is, there is no defined length of term for the Governor-General in statute, other than what is put in their terms of appointment when they are actually they take up the job. It's a non-statutory provision. They suggest putting a clear provision in this bill for the Governor-General's term to not exceed 5 years, and that seems fair enough to me. While all of these democratic proposals were advanced by the Republican movement, they are not Republican in and of themselves. They are just simply democratic proposals. However, another submitter, Derek Round, not only proposed similar democratic steps for the selection of the Governor-General, but also associated this move with a move away from the monarchy. In addition to the Governor-General being appointed by Parliament, Derek Round proposed that, quote, on the death, abdication or appointment of a regency of Queen Elizabeth II, her heir and successor will cease to be the head of state and King or Queen of New Zealand. The Governor-General will continue to exercise all the powers and prerogatives of that office and assume and exercise all the powers and prerogatives previously exercised by Queen Elizabeth II, end quote. So there is a body of opinion in New Zealand that holds that Queen Elizabeth II should be our last monarch, the last Queen or King of New Zealand, and we should now move to work out a transition from the end of her reign to a republic. And not long after Derek Round made that submission to the Select Committee, and completely separate from the Select Committee process, our former Deputy Prime Minister Michael Cullen came up with a similar proposal at the Constitution Conference here in Wellington. He said that there should be legislation, quote, to provide that the choice of Governor-General, strictly speaking constitutionally the nomination, should henceforth be made by a supermajority of Parliament, say 75%. The same legislation could provide that on the death of the Queen, the Governor-General would become head of state, end quote. So there you are, like minds think alike. Great minds think alike, I should say. I should say at this point that the Green Party does not have an official position on whether New Zealand should become a republic or when and how, although I personally am very much a Republican, having had a private member's bill on the issue before Parliament which didn't quite succeed, although all of my Green colleagues did support it to the first reading. This bill also deals with the costs of the Governor-General, and they are quite substantial. The latest budget lists $7.6 million in ongoing operational expenses and $11.6 million to upgrade Government House. The elected President of Ireland will cost less this financial year, namely $6 million. So republics are not expensive, contrary to what some people argue. One of the reasons for the difference in cost between New Zealand and Ireland might be the certain excesses in the way we throw money at the Governor-General, which are indicated in this bill. For example, why does a piece of legislation have to provide, as this bill does, for, quote, the use of chauffeured cars when he or she, that is the Governor-General, no longer holds office as Governor-General, end quote. And also the 6 months redundancy pay is not a bad lark, amounting to $96,000, not to mention an annuity for the rest of the former Governor-General's life, currently at $62,000 a year. Mind you, our present Governor-General, Anand Sanchinad, hasn't done too bad. He's a friendly, competent person with an inclusive style, and as previous speakers have said, he's had to suffer some racist comment lately from the TV host Paul Henry, who questioned whether he was a real New Zealander. According to Mr Henry, he didn't sound or look like a real New Zealander, presumably because of his Indian ethnicity, and it's ironic that Paul Henry's first defence when challenged was that he was a monarchist and so he couldn't really be against the Governor-General. I say ironically because the British royal line is so multicultural, they all look and sound the same, because they're all of the same ethnic line of European ethnicity and all speak with the same traditionally upper caste English.